Episode 7 of Training Day with Coach Hawke with a very special guest, folks. This is an interview series for wrestling fans about how pro wrestlers train and what training is like. And I've got a legend, a living legend with me today. Somebody who, as you know, I'm from the Quebec territory and somebody who is very much responsible for all of us breaking out all over the world. Folks, today I am with the legendary founder of the IWS, Sexxxy Eddy. Sexxxy Eddy, how you doing, bud?
I'm good, actually, but I'm standing in for Sexxxy Eddy. I'm Sexxxy Eddy's grandfather.
Oh, okay.
I'll be doing the rest of this interview again, hence the beard and everything. And people are like, that beard, he's not too sexy. Let me tell you, kids, sexy is a state of mind, okay?
It is.
It's your confidence so that, you know, we're all sexy. I've been wrestling for a long time.
You have.
And we throw that word legend around. So like 20 years, but I've got to travel a bit of the globe. Doing this thing called we love to call professional wrestling, and you know, working on my crafting and perfecting it, or trying to perfect something that's pretty broken. But you know, I'm still kicking it. I sleep in my air chamber every night so I can try and stay young. I work at Hema Quebec, also the blood drive. So I try and drink blood every day to try and keep young,
which is really how we got to be breaking out, was the blood drinking incident from Tournament of Death, right?
Exactly. So again, internet was just starting up and stuff, and when we had to travel, we had to go around the globe, and we had to give VHS cassettes to try and give, like, it was like almost a CD, a wrestling CD, a little bit of where we've been to, like, you know, a little paper with all the feds I've worked with. So after handing those and mailing those around, we got contacted. And so that was my debut in the U.S. that time. And that was, again, I don't want to go ahead of myself, but then the blood squirting thing, it opened a lot of doors for a lot of people. And it was a blessing in disguise. That's how I best describe it. It's not something I would recommend. And it's not something that I would want to do at every show where promoters would say, hey, can you do that? Cut your vein.
Isn't that your finish? That's not your finish these days?
Your finish. Just throw blood on everybody. I mean, I almost finished myself and ended my wrestling career, because after that I was kind of like, no, this isn't for me. But then going back in and everything, and I didn't have to pay any hospital bills. That was a big plus because of my charm. I used my charm with the nurses and the doctors in the States, and I was able to get scot-free.
Attaboy.
And I think it's over 10 years, so I don't think they can get me now and come back and, you know. So
don't worry. Everything you say here is privileged information, obviously. As a lawyer, as your lawyer, I can say you'll be fine.
Top secret. Top gun, baby.
Hey, Eddy, so we're talking about your U.S. debut. We're getting a little bit ahead of ourselves, but I mean, that is like a big deal. But yeah, well, slow it down there, their kid, rookie, huh? Pappy Eddy, the grandfather of Sexxxy Eddy, with me here on Training Day with Coach Hawke. Eddy, though, let's get into my three-question high spot formula here. We talked about breaking out in the States, but let's go back to your origin story, so to speak. Eddy, where did you go to professional wrestling school, if you did, and what was the experience like?
Well, okay, so again, we all start out being a fan. We start out in our backyards and stuff, playing with our friends.
Yep.
It's when you decide to take that fork in the road of, was it just playing, or do I actually want to go and pursue this? So again, I didn't even know that was an option. I had to search far and wide. Like I said before, no internet. You had to go to places or word of mouth. And I had some friends say, hey, there's like a little wrestling league. One of my buddies, let's go check it out in a church basement. So again, it spreads like that. Once you're in the world of wrestling, you know everything. It's like, I mean, you find out there's so many shows happening the same weekend.
Yeah.
But when you're not in that world, it's all like, you know, you see a flyer randomly or something, and it's like, that's how you sign up. So I started with the school. Actually, even before starting training, I met up some friends, met Manny and Nick Patterson.
The founders of the IWS.
Yeah. And so again, no training yet, but we all had a love for wrestling. And again, where did we meet? At a bar, cheap bar. The booze wasn't expensive. You know, not too far from a place where the chicken wings weren't expensive and they played pay-per-views. Yeah, so, you know, again, it was right down my alley of not paying a lot of money, which every wrestler, take that as a lesson.
Yes.
Save as much money as you can, okay?
Legendary money saver, Sexxxy Eddy, financial advice.
You need to put the Taco Bell sauces in your pocket, you know, that's going to be your lunch for later.
Yep.
Hey, you do what you got to do.
You got to do what you got to do. Hey.
Bob Saget said it best in, you know, sometimes you have to do certain things to, you know, to make money. You know, again, I won't, we're training day with Coach Hawke.
PG, so, PG show. This is a family PG, show.
PG, family. Mm-hmm. So anyways, starting with Manny and stuff like that, we tried to incorporate some weapons and work on some things because we all had a love for wrestling, sure. Especially like the Japanese style and ECW style. I learned that a little bit from Manny with tape traders. Mm-hmm. So we were building up some weapons at the beginning. And then at the same time, I said, I'd like to get some training because this is something that I wanted to do. We all had different goals. I know like Manny was more for a company, starting a wrestling company.
Right.
I was more for becoming a wrestler. Like I really mm-hmm. wanted to learn everything I can. And Nick Patterson was more seeing like the dollar signs. Again, we had three goals, the common goals a little bit, but they all spread out. So I knew that being as a founder of IWS, which we started doing at Little Leagues while I was learning wrestling training and showing the guys what I had learned on some crash mats.
Where did you take that training?
Yeah, I was going at NCW school with, I'm going to say the best trainer in Quebec wrestling, Mark the Grizzly,
right.
And Marc Quillon, still a friend of mine on Facebook. And every time he wished me a happy birthday, I still say, thanks a lot, coach.
That's really bug. That,
yeah. he loves to hunt.
He does love to hunt.
Yes.
Shout out Mark the Grizzly.
Yeah, like that's the name, you know. Hey, he's a bear. He's a bear there. he's really a Care Bear. That's what he is. But so as I'm doing training classes, at the same time, I wanted to incorporate with these guys, Manny and Nick, a little bit of hardcore element that no one was doing in Quebec, and also for the English demographic.
Right.
Because again, there's a lot of English wrestling fans, and even the French wrestling fans would have to watch wrestling when it wasn't translated yet. They'd watch it in English.
Sure.
So, and again, some wrestlers learned their English. Kevin Owens, yes. Watching good old JR. And yeah. It's just, you know how much wrestling can influence young minds and when you can learn a whole language.
Especially so when Kevin's dropping words like slobber knocker and expecting everyone in mainstream America to just know what he's talking about.
Yeah. His third grade teacher, slobber knocker. I don't know if that that went off well.
As long as he spelled it properly, I don't see an issue with it. But
I don't even know how to spell that. So it sounds, it just sounds, it's like Jabberwocky. It's a really big one, but it's a big one. Big one.
The good one in Scrabble, right? Yeah. Lots of points. Big one.
Lots
yeah.
of points. again, Shane's gonna try and do this to me a lot and knock me off course, but I'm gonna try and get back on course. NCW training, yeah. That was where I got it. Was and I learned the proper way because I think bullying in Quebec in all of wrestling was starting to get its way out of wrestling.
Sure.
Because at the beginning, and a lot of old school timers were kind of they wanted to make sure they wanted to keep it safe, the secret safe, like the magician's code, and really protect it. But by protecting it, by almost hurting some of the kids or making them suffer so that if they want to continue, they can see there's a drive, which I found that was kind of on its way out. Cause I learned the proper way. I mean, we had to bump on mats at least 1,000 times mm-hmm. before, and then we got to go in the ring and everything and practice in the ring. But that was when we were ready, our coach said, okay, we're on a basketball, on a hardwood floor. And mm-hmm. he's like, okay, I want to see 3 bumps.
Yeah.
And like, on the floor. And it's kind of like, you know, you kind of freak out because some other schools were doing the reverse. They make you learn on the floor
first,
and people hurt their backs and coccyx or the tailbone. And then you don't want to do anything with wrestling. You're like,
right.
Forget this.
I'm weeding people out, right? Like the weaker of us.
Chess player. I want to be the next Bobby Fischer, you know? So,
of course.
So that's, which is no problem with that. I love chess also. I'm a big fan of the chess.
It's a great game. Yeah. Definitely a great game. So yeah, there was that bullying. I mean, I personally, even when I broke in around 2002, 2003, it was a thing, but it was on its way out for sure. And now I think that we know a lot better and our careers are lasting longer accordingly.
Our bodies are not like, again, if you're not doing something properly, then you're setting yourself up for injury.
Yeah.
And I mean, again, you don't do anything probably if you don't do like a deadlift. The deadlift is like in the gym, it's one of those exercises where it's like, if you don't do it properly, you injure yourself.
Yeah.
Like that's one of them that I stay away from, because again, it's certain things that I'm like, I prefer. Oh, thank you, honey. Certain things that I prefer to, if I'm not sure 100%, ask your coach or ask someone to really show you, to fine tune it so that you can do things properly.
Absolutely. So if you can't do it safely, don't do it at all, kind of thing, which I do preach quite a bit at my, in my own classes. I agree with you entirely that if you cannot do it, like there are people who want to try something new, for example, and that's fine. But I always say practice it first. Make sure it's safe. That's the number one thing for me, is safety and security, and not, as somebody who's, I'm 32 turning 33 this year, and I'm unable to wrestle now due to injury. It's very important for me for my progeny.
I just turned 103.
Congratulations.
Yeah, so yeah.
You don't look a day over 69.
No, thank you very much.
You're welcome. You're welcome. Well, we just spoke about deadlifts, which is a nice segue to my.
I'll get to that part. I'm gonna keep going with the training part a little bit, and then we'll get to that. It's just to practice anything we practice, to practice and know how we're doing it properly.
Right.
Because then you're just gonna keep hurting yourself worse. So, anyways, Mark the Grizzly was great at that, at showing us the proper ways to do certain things. And then after that, it was character development and everything. And then as I got better at wrestling and more confident, that's when we branched out. And again, getting to go to different provinces. To wrestle or even like that was a big thing, and even getting paid in pocket change, I was like, oh, this is so cool, you know?
Yeah,
because I was like, first time getting paid, people will always remember that. And so again, from there, then it went to the US debut breaking out. Again, I was recognized because of the deathmatch skills, which I always tell people also, start out with wrestling good training before you go and try to do death matches.
Right, of course.
Because again, you're going to end your career too early and prematurely. Mm-hmm. But that opened the door for me to US. And then I got to go to different countries, going to Japan, Germany, and England, where I never thought that pro wrestling, that where the winners and the losers are predetermined, that you can make money and they're going to pay for your flights and pay for hotels and I mean pay for food and then the women come with that, and I mean it's tremendous.
The female wrestlers, that's right, they come along too, they wrestle as well. Yeah, definitely.
Yes, they do. So yeah. Like again, it's great, it's good. And so again, that's the whole training aspect and my how I got to from point A to point Z.
Breaking in.
I don't want to say Z because that sounds like the end of my career.
Shouldn't we say alphabet. Point triple X at this point?
There you go.
That's pretty good. Okay, moving along then. Let's get into your actual training now. We spoke about your wrestling school experience, but these days, you're still in pretty good shape for a guy who's 69 years old. What I would like to know is, what do you do to keep in ring shape physically and mentally? Like, I know you're a big race guy. That's something.
Well, again, the first thing and most important thing is I try to, when I drink a lot, I alternate. Drink with both hands, people. Sometimes people only drink with one hand. And again, no, that's not good. No, just kidding.
But not.
I'm a big, I've been slowing down during COVID and stuff. Sure. But again, I want to let you know, I'm getting my vaccine on Monday.
Nice.
And just that glimmer of hope for me, that's kind of given me more of a reason, because it's that means we're one step closer for things opening up.
Right.
That means we're one step closer to having live wrestling shows. And at first I was down in the dumps, and again, it took a toll mentally.
Yeah.
But so now with that, knowing that I'm at the first step, the first dose on Monday, I'm like, you know what? I got to pick myself up, because there's no one that'll pick you up. People can help you, but you got to do it yourself.
Absolutely.
And so physically, I love running. I love obstacle courses. It's called OCRs.
Is that the technical term? Like that's a technical term. OCRs.
Complicated jargon.
Okay, cool.
I could just turn the camera really fast, because this motivates me a lot by seeing this. Is like when I got on.
Oh wow! Look at that.
So I got more accolades in racing than I do for wrestling, which is kind of cool. And at one point I was gonna switch passions, because it actually gave me a new life a new love for wrestling.
Right.
Because I was going to the gym less. I kind of found it dull, but here you're playing. It's like a giant playground for adults. You're climbing, you're going under things, you're going through mud. I've encouraged, actually, a couple wrestlers have done this transition too and tried it out, which I encourage everyone to. And again,
including our referee King from the IWS, Giancarlo, who's been doing them as well.
He's not bad. I tend to beat him though on the races, but that's okay. He's just a referee, right?
Yeah. He'll get there.
He'll
hang in there, kid. You'll get there.
Yeah, he's going to give me crap right after this when he sees this. But I'm just saying I've gotten people from all walks of life, and I really encourage them. And it's gotten my love of wrestling back up, because I felt we always need something to strive towards in life.
Sure.
When you just go to work Monday to Friday and you got your weekend, you don't know what to do, which has been the case kind of for COVID. You're like, what do I do now? And I realized, like, what all other people that didn't have maybe passions, as we did share with wrestling, how it feels like to not have anything to look forward to. And I found that was really hurting me mentally. So again, like I was saying, physically, running is something that it's like therapeutic. It kind of cleared my mind a little bit, but doing these races, I'd have those to look forward to. And I'd run once or twice a week in between. And that was one of the years I was in the best shape of my life. You know, there's something with running up and getting to the top of a mountain that really, it enlightens you. It opens up things in your brain. And I'm telling you, touching the clouds, I did Mount Killington in Vermont, which is one of the big ones. And for me, that was amazing to be up in the clouds. Again, I do all my races in my underwear. I got to stay true to the gimmick. So
living the gimmick, brother.
People were laughing at me at the beginning. Who's this clown in his underwear? And then they're seeing me actually pass a lot of them and seeing me every weekend at different races. And they were like, oh, and then they got to know me. And then they're like, pro wrestler. And then I come to the shows, man. And just like I tell wrestlers, hey, you're looking for something different to do workout? Come to some races.
Hell yeah.
So I'm just an advocate for fun. That's, you know, if you're having fun, that's the best thing. And if you're going to have one life goal in life, is just to have the most fun possible. That's what I say is your ultimate life goal. You can have little life goals at the beginning. Mm-hmm. Like, you know, I want to do 30 pushups today. That's, you know, you can reach that. That's easy. You know, then you build up your goals, but you always have to have simple goals. And I think that helps for mental, for you mentally,
right.
To have smaller goals to reach. If you try too big, you're just going to reach disappointment, and it sucks. So it's like, start with small goals. And so in the gym, start with small goals, you know, before you run a mountain, you know, jog a little bit, do some treadmill, try some
building
rowing.
Blocks, right? We're walking exactly. Before running, literally.
Do the easy stuff, but then, you know, you need to do some weights, because it will prevent a worse injury.
Yes, of course.
And I could take a perfect example of Brock Lesnar versus Kurt Angle. Brock doing a shooting star press. Again, for anyone to do that move, it's pretty impressive. For a guy his weight, his size, he could have broken his neck. But because he was so in shape and so built there, it you know, maybe he tore a muscle, maybe he tore something. It was less, it could have been paralysis.
Right, of course.
So again, I tell everyone, you know, it doesn't matter. Okay, your style is this or whatever, this is that. You know, a little bit of exercise, a little bit of working out, whatever you can do and have people encourage you to do it. Some people work better alone. They want to put their headphones and do their thing. Some people, they like better some teamwork. So find what's better for you, but do something. Whatever you do something. It's going to help you in the long run. And even if you're not doing weight training, if you do karate school, if you do ballet, if you do gymnastics, any sport will help you. And we talked about chess before, actually.
Yep.
That'll even help your brain think up moves ahead. Anything you do, you can incorporate into wrestling, and it could make you better. It might even help create the character that you're going to become.
Absolutely, absolutely. Yeah. So having fun also, like building blocks and having fun while doing it, but doing something. Get out there and move. That's
the only way you're going to continue and do it for a long time. And then it doesn't become a chore anymore.
Right.
Oh, it's working out. You become, hey, this is the best moment right now. Oh yes, it's the working out part. Oh, I'm going to get that adrenaline pumping. I'm going to feel great. I'm starting my day good, or I'm ending my day good on a high note.
Mm-hmm.
And you know, once you train, you sleep better. You go to sleep faster, you wake, you get a better, deeper sleep and everything. So the physical part is super important. I want to really touch on the mental aspect though, because whatever, like I said, you give yourself reasonable goals at the beginning, right. Things that are easier to achieve, because you're gonna be let down, and you don't want to let down yourself. It's one thing to have the encouragement of other people, but in the end, you have the ultimate say on what you're going to do, how far you're going to go. So that's really important. You have to be good in your head, and little things that you can do in your house even is like having a clean workspace.
Yep.
Like it took me years before I actually cleaned my desk.
Yeah,
and
sure.
I just had a pile of junk on there.
Yeah.
It was always bothering me in the back of my head. And it was like little things. When you have a clean environment, when you have more of a structure in your day, some routine,
making those your bed.
Those things all help.
Yeah.
You know, they all help in everything you do. I'd wake up sometimes and anxiety. Why am I waking up and my heart's beating? I didn't have a bad dream or anything. Mm-hmm. But it's just that there's something that I needed to do, especially when I was younger. I didn't understand this and it wasn't talked about. I'd sometimes do these random things. Like I'd see a street sign and I had to divide the letters. I'd split stuff up. And I had actually talked to someone not too long ago, and he told me that was a neurological divergence. And sorry, the big word, yeah. I just learned it not too long ago, but he said sometimes it people that have certain aspects that their brain finds solutions in a different way.
Processes information also, differently.
Yeah, it's also good because then you could attack problems at different angles.
Right.
So it gives you different ideas. But I didn't know this. As a kid, I kind of was like, okay, I'm doing weird stuff. Let me just stop doing it. And after a while, it went away. But I'd still wake up sometimes like I have unfinished business. And I try to go back to sleep and I'd be up for 3 hours. Like if I would have known every time then that I'd wake up like that, I would have went out and ran. And that would have probably helped. Again, see what my problem is and stuff like that. So the physical and the mental are very close together.
It's
especially times like now. And I'm going to let anyone know, if anyone wrestling or you're in the wrestling world, give me a call, write to me on Facebook, because talking is one of the best remedies.
Agreed.
When you have a good support system and good friends to count on, you know, whether I'm just having a so-so day or something serious happened in your life, you know, if it's the passing of a relative, you know, something happened that's really significant, don't be afraid to just talk to people, because we've all been through different things, different points in our lives. And if I can help, especially I'm realizing this more as I'm getting older, the wisdom is kicking in, but the more that I can help someone realize their dreams, then maybe that's what my goal, that's what I'm here to do.
That's,
you know,
what I'm here for as a coach, man. That's like, this is what this is right now. That's awesome. What we're doing, right? We're here to help the next generation, so to speak. Even if this helps one person, I consider it a success.
Yeah, because instead of, like I said, the old school mentality of keeping people down, here, if we can bring people up, and you know what? Not be jealous that, hey, I didn't get to the WWE, so no one will. No.
No.
What I learned now, and again, I know it goes into the time genie question, but what you know now, if you can help yourself, but you can help yourself by helping the younger students.
Yep.
So if you can do that to them, you know what? And then you see them in WWE, you can be proud for yourself too.
And you can charge them the 15% finder's fee for signing to WWE. Like, it's perfect.
Always
right?
The money.
but I agree with you. Like, a high tide lifts all ships, right?
I want to take the time too that you're never too old to do some seminars, because I wanted to mention that, like, again, one of the best things that I did, and I waited 20 years to do it, was take the master class with yourself, with Quack and Solo Darling, because I saw things that, man, I've been doing this all the time as I was doing it. I didn't really know why. Once you understand why you're doing it, you can even make it better.
Yes, exactly.
So, I mean, doing that seminar, it really helped me. And I thought, I was embarrassed, because I thought, I'm going to get there and all eyes are going to be on me when it's my turn in the ring. And like, oh, let's see what this guy who's been for 20 years doing. So it made me nervous. But then I got comfortable and I'm like, hey, we're all peers. No one's judging.
Exactly.
We're trying to improve. It's again, taking out that bullying mentality and bringing in the helping and paying it forward mentality.
That is something that I've been trying to impart on my students and just in the IWS training center in general. Like when you come in, everybody's an equal. Myself included. I don't like to put myself above my students in a way that, like, yes, I'm here to impart my wisdom and I've learned, I have lessons that can help you very much along the way. But I want everybody to feel as if we are all just like, we're the locker room, you know? And I think that holding people down is a mistake. And I think that the better that everybody else does, the better it is for us. And like, you know,
everybody,
the more happiness that you put into the world, the more happiness will come back to you. So in a selfish way, being nice to people, make people be nice to you and your life is easier.
Yeah, but it's not selfish. It's not, don't think of it that way. I know, but in one way you could look at it like that, but yeah, it's not.
But you understand like my point here, not selfish, but it is still not self-fulfilling, but it's an improvement to your general environment.
Yeah.
If you have a net improvement on your general environment and everybody else is putting each other first like that, you're going to do a lot better than if you're at each other's throats. And I genuinely believe that.
Yeah. And I can also say too, just like negativity spreads like a virus, so does positivity. Yes. And I mean, if you're going to be, oh, I can't get this arm drag. I can't get it. I can't do it. I'm like, I try it and everyone else is getting it. We're all blocked at certain moves. Sometimes there's certain things that we just can't, you know, it takes a while.
Absolutely.
To cross that hump. But also, if you're like, hey, man, I'm feeling great, you're giving a good energy, everyone else, the room will feel that energy. Mm-hmm. And it just spreads good energy. So that's also a thing to look at. Like, again, I know sometimes we have some problems and stuff, like people say, don't bring your problems to work, because then, again, it downs the mood. And then every time before you're going to go to work, you're going to be already thinking like, oh, I got to see this person. Oh, it's down the mood.
Sure.
Like, you know,
sure.
It takes a while to do that. And it took me way a lot longer to start doing that. But it's helped me already. I feel I had a lot of gray hairs pop out when I was stressed. And now maybe they're going away. I don't know if... Maybe I could be digressing. Maybe I got that Benjamin Buttons complex. I mean, I might turn back into a baby in a couple of years.
I the thing is, grandfather Eddie, who is not actually Eddie, you're Eddie's grandfather. I think you look remarkably good, much like your grandson. And
Thank you very much.
Aging gracefully. But no, you do look great though. And even for somebody who hasn't wrestled in forever, you're still like, You're pretty good. I saw you at the grocery store the other day. You had a nice cut to you. It was great.
I was doing the groceries by myself. I wasn't having them ordered online. I actually lift the bags too and everything.
Yeah. Yes. See, that's you can lift your own
bags. I'm a good boy. Yes.
So, okay. So now we've spoken about grandfathers and Benjamin Buttons. And that is an excellent segue into the question of the time genie. Sexxxy Eddy. You encounter a time genie. The time genie sends you back to your first day of wrestling class. And whether that wants to be the first day with Manny or this is the first day with Mark the Grizzly, I'm going to let you choose.
However, together. I want them both.
Simultaneously, multiple timelines. I'm so in. The time genie will let you say one thing to yourself. You don't know if you will take the advice or not because you're just some random guy, whatever. And as soon as you say that one thing, you get sucked right back into the present. So you have to make it count. Eddie. What do you say to your past self?
First off, I need to have an old grizzled veteran voice so that, you know, the young self knows this guy knows what he's talking about.
Shout out to Mitch Ryder.
Shout out, man. Rest in peace. And rest in peace, baby. I bring my fanny pack and, you know, I tell the kid, you better have some of these. Better have some of these. They're going to save you a lot of money in the long run.
Oh, boy.
Yeah, no.
So let's go to training now.
That was my funny answer.
It was a good joke. It was a good bit. Prop humor is underrated.
Safety first. Again, I would, you know, that's very good. And, you know, it's good. But what I would tell myself, and I've maybe kicked myself in the butt when I was younger about this, and then I've learned to accept it, was please don't be afraid of rejection. Okay.
Nice.
The worst thing someone could say to you, and then this goes into wrestling and it also goes into relationships. Because I also help out people with that if people have questions. The worst thing the girl's gonna say is no. The worst thing a promoter's gonna say is no.
We listen to them when they say no.
Right? We do. Yeah, exactly. Ears open, mouth closed whenever there's classes, but because you know what? You keep doing wrestling, keep doing what you do best, And then they'll end up asking you, hey, you want to come and wrestle for us? Mm-hmm. And, you know, so at the beginning, don't be afraid of rejection. It was something that I was always nervous of. And I thought, no, I don't want to give my CV. I don't want to apply to WWE. Yeah, no, I'm not big enough. No, I'm not this. You know what? You never know what they're looking for. Perfect examples of that. You got Colin Delaney. We've both got to work with him from the Olsen twins.
Who just got engaged recently. Congratulations, Colin Delaney.
Oh, wow. Good stuff. You know, and when he told me, he's like, I even got a figurine of myself. And he's like, every time they did the Ric Flair send-off, he's in the background. Yeah. He gets like a little royalty check or something. Good for him. I'm like, super cool, you know?
Hell yeah, get paid.
But even then, I was like, I was nervous for a long time. James Ellsworth, again, another guy there.
We don't like him. No.
But again, you know, anybody can make it. So that was one thing that I was nervous for. And I was not like comfortable with myself. Like, I don't have the 8-pack of abs. I'm not big enough. I'm not strong enough. People are faster. But whatever they might be looking for at that time, you might also be the perfect combination of a little bit of everything.
Right.
And the exact combination of what they're looking for. So again, the time that I was more interested in WWE, again, it was they were looking for bigger guys. Now's the time where guys, there's athletes in every background of sports. They're not only looking for football players, former football players that are injured, that are bodybuilders. They're looking for guys that excelled in any sport, that have something new to bring to the product. And who knows, you might be, even if it's a manager, if they want you as a spokesperson for someone, not to say that, you know, you'd be like, well, I'm better than that, I'm a wrestler, but you know what? You're getting to be on the biggest stage possible. And when you're on the biggest stage, you have the most influence to help other people. You can help them or you can also deter them. But you know what? Again, using that positivity, help people, it'll spread. And that's what I can do right now to anybody out there. And, you know, that's awesome. And if you have any questions, please contact me, contact Hawk, because I want to do more to help out all the younger people that are interested in wrestling. Because if that's what I have left to give, then let me give what I can give.
I mean, I'm going to go ahead and say, don't doubt yourself now and take your own advice. Maybe that's not all you've had left to give, Eddie. I think there's still quite a bit to be done in the industry for somebody with your skill set and your talents and your ability to only be a PG wrestler and having a grandfather who looks exactly like you. All of these are positive gimmicks that could easily take you very far. But that being said, I do think that you have quite a bit left to offer to the industry, and I'm not really ready for you to hang up your boots yet. So while I do agree that you can help some people, I mean, what if I ever come back and I need to have an old guy carry me, you know, Eddie, you might have to do me that. Give me the rub, kid, so to speak. Now, if people do want to contact you though, how would they do it? Where, like, you want to get some plugs in? What's the social media? I know that you're Jim Cornette's favorite wrestler on Twitter.
Yeah, I am. I'm on MySpace. If you want to join my MySpace,
AOL instant messenger chat,
or is that, that doesn't exist anymore. No, I actually have this thing I'm working on. I'm trying to do some sketches again. If I can't do things in the ring, I'm still trying to entertain. I'm on Cumyo. So Cumyo, it's kind of my platform of doing videos and stuff to help people out. I see you scratching your head, but look, you know, I don't have enough fans for Cameo. I had to invent my own thing.
Hey, good for you.
So I'm just going to be making people laugh for a bit. But again, any wrestling advice you want to ask me through Facebook, I'm easy to, I'm always hard, but I'm never hard to find.
Right.
You know, you got Twitter, on Instagram. Again, what I can't even remember what
I think you're at Sexxxy Eddy with 3X's 69 on Twitter.
Yeah. How do you know that? I forgot.
And then on Instagram, like, you're only one Naked Eddie, if that's correct.
That's the word.
Yeah.
Oh, the brain. That's why they call him the professor.
I did my research. And then, of course, you have your Facebook, which you are all over Facebook under your real name. So I don't know if you want to share that. That's up to you. Yeah. But you do have 5,000 people, so it's not like they can add you anyway.
But you can write me whatever messages or send me, you know, if you have a motivational picture of yourself in like a bikini, send me that too, because it motivates me to go to the gym more.
Yes, of course, right? Of course. I,
yes.
I can appreciate the educator side to you. Absolutely. The way you just want to help people through their bikini pictures is just so appreciated. So guys out there who are wrestling trainers, make sure you send him plenty of bikini photos.
Yes.
Instagram models, especially. Yeah. Folks, this has been Training Day with Coach Hawke, with one of the founders of the IWS and a veritable Quebec wrestling legend, Canadian wrestling legend, dare I say, Sexxxy Eddy and his grandfather. Eddie, thank you for tuning in. And folks, thank you for tuning in. For myself, the IWS, the IWS Hardcore Dojo, for youtube.com/IWS Hardcore, and at IWS Hardcore on every single platform. Folks, we'll see you next time.
Rock out with your hawk out.
Oh.
I didn't know if you cut that off, but I was like, you were going to say, oh, he's going to say cock out. So-